I'm excited to introduce our next speaker, whom I met when I interned in the Heritage Foundation's Young Leader Program and received the opportunity to learn from the conservative movement's most influential experts. A native of Montreal, Quebec, David Azerrad studies the American political tradition from the founding all the way through today, with an emphasis on its contemporary political movements. He also teaches classes on American conservative and progressive political thought at American University. His writings have appeared in various publications, including The Weekly Standard, Real Clear Politics, The Federalist, among many others. He can also be found on national television in the U.S., Canada, and the United Kingdom. Azerrad received a doctoral degree in politics from the University of Dallas, where he wrote a dissertation on the foundation of John Locke's political thought. He received a bachelor's degree in journalism and political science from Concordia University in Montreal, and a master's of arts in political science from Carleton University in Ottawa. Please join me in welcoming Dr. David Azerrad.
Thanks. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me okay with the mic? Is it working? Yes. It's very nice to be here, and I recognize some of the faces in the audience from former Heritage interns. I have long admired the work that YAF does, and it's a great honor to be here with you this afternoon. We're here to talk about socialism. So you guys, I was going to say, do you remember Bernie Sanders? Of course you do. Even though he did not win the 2016 election, heck, he didn't even get the nomination, all of us are still feeling the burn today all across this great country. And I say this not because the cantankerous independent senator from Vermont has embarked on yet another quixotic quest to become president. I think this will soon be forgotten. No. Sanders has succeeded in doing what no other politician in American history had ever done. He has made the term socialism reputable in America. This, I predict, will be his legacy. You could call it the afterburn if you wanted. America has always been an outlier in the developed world when it comes to socialism. We've never even flirted with it. The famous Harvard sociologist Seymour Martin Lipset wrote a book called It Didn't Happen Here, Why Socialism Failed in the United States. And by failed, he didn't mean we tried it and it didn't work out like in the Soviet Union. He meant failed as in it never gained a following. It never became popular. We've had a socialist party in America in various forms since 1876, but these parties have always been on the fringes of our political life. And yet, we're here in 2019, and large majorities of Democrats and young people identify as socialists. Bernie remains a towering figure in our politics, and even though I don't think he'll be president, his ideas are gaining ground. Do you know how many senators have co-sponsored Medicare for All? 16. And then if you look at the House of Representatives, 118 members of the House have co-sponsored Medicare for all of them Democrats. That's the majority of the Democratic caucus. Meanwhile, Senorita Ocasio-Cortez, who also identifies as a socialist, she has given us the Green New Deal, which of course Senator Sanders endorses, and which would cost America trillions of dollars and millions of jobs. So what's happening? Well, if you look at the right and our reaction to all of this, it's been pretty predictable. The main one is really a sense of despair and dismay. We conservatives and libertarians are looking at this happening, especially the young people, and saying, I don't understand. Have we learned nothing from the 20th century? Are we condemned to repeat the errors of the past? My friend Ben Dominich, for example, the editor of The Federalist, wrote a piece in Commentary magazine in which he lamented the fact that America may need to relearn the hard lessons of the past by being confronted with a renascent socialism. There, I guess maybe the only optimistic blind spot we seem to see on the right is it's good for business to be able to attack the left for being socialists. That a lot of us seem to think we can capitalize on this electorally and as a movement to hammer at them hard for being socialists. So Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, for example, has said that the path for success for the Republican Party in 2020 is to, quote, be a firewall that saves the country from socialism. Now look, I am all for hammering the left. And I hate socialism as much as the next Heritage Foundation employee who wrote a dissertation on John Locke and fled Quebec to come live in the land of the free in America. That said, I am not entirely convinced that the conservative libertarian diagnosis of what is going on is entirely correct. I am not fully convinced that we understand what is going on today. Here is my worry. I worry that maybe we're looking at the present through the lens of the past, and as a result, misunderstanding what is happening. How many of you here know the most hackneyed of all cliches, that George Santayana quote, "Those who misunderstand the forget the past, blah, 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 are condemned to repeat it," right? By the way, please don't ever use that in an undergraduate essay. You may think it's clever when you read it for the first time. Put yourself in the shoes of your professor who has seen that quote 800 times already. It loses its sparkle very rapidly. I would offer to you the following consideration. Those who look at the present only through the past are condemned to misunderstand it. American conservatism, you will remember, took shape as an anti-communist movement after World War II. We spent four decades fighting Marxist communism in the USSR. I think, like all people, we prefer to fight the enemy we already know. But what if the enemy is different this time around? This is the first rule of war. You need to know your enemy. Who then are these socialists? Are they Marxists? Are they communists? What is their end goal? And why are so many people, in particular young people, being seduced by their rhetoric? These are the questions I want to tackle today with the view I want to make clear to understanding clearly what we're up against so that we can defeat it. I want us to have clarity on what is happening. So let's begin with the polls, okay? Because the polls are what everyone talks about. And I find it is the main driver of despair on the right, especially amongst older conservatives. Oh my God, look at these kids, look at these polls. X percentage of Democrats and of millennials and of Generation Zs support socialism. So first, the bad news. It is true that majorities of Democrats and of young people in America today look favorably upon socialism. This is undeniable. So last summer, for example, Gallup reported that for the first time since they've been asking this question in over 10 years, Democrats have a more favorable view of socialism than they do of capitalism. And in March, Axios released the results of the polls that found that Generation Z, any of you here Zers? Okay, well, you can be proud. You are the generation in American history that shows the highest level of support for socialism. And that along with millennials, the two of you express very high degrees of support for socialist principles and policies. And these findings are reported on with frenzy by the media. Why? Because they want to break the will of the American people. They want to convince Americans that it's all over. The arc of history is long and it bends towards socialism. Look, all of the young people agree with this. Therefore, don't oppose us. That's why they do it that way, to break your will. Now, here is the key thing you need to know about all of these polls. They never ask the participants what socialism is and what capitalism is. They never define for the participants what socialism is or what capitalism is. They all contain a disclaimer saying, we just pose the question, you fill in the blanks regarding the meaning of the term. And so what happens when you start to look into these polls, which I would encourage all of you to do, is you start to realize that many people do not know what these terms mean. So I'll give you my favorite example. Just now in June, Pew did a big poll on socialism and capitalism. They found that a majority of Democrats support socialism. But you know what they also found? A majority of Democrats also support what? Capitalism. Now, how is that possible? How can you support both capitalism and socialism? They're fundamentally incompatible, right? Well, during the Cold War they were, but the Cold War ended 30 years ago. Language is not static. It's organic and alive and it moves. Let me give you an example that I love. The word artificial today in America, is that a good thing? No. You look artificial, that thing you're wearing is artificial? No, it's bad. But if you read Shakespeare, if you look at the English language 500 years ago, artificial was a good thing. It was a term of praise. It meant you were displaying your artifice. Then Rousseau came along with the Romantics, and the emphasis was on spontaneity, on authenticity, and artificial came to mean fake, contrived, not authentic, not real, and it became a bad term. So to me, the really interesting polls are the ones that ask Americans, what is socialism and what is capitalism? And when you look at these polls, one thing that becomes rapidly clear is that whatever brand of socialism is gaining support in America, it is not Marx and Lenin's. The latest poll I found by Gallup found that 17% of Americans support socialism along the Marxist-Leninist lines of, here's the definitions they gave, government ownership or control, government ownership of utilities, everything controlled by the government, state control of business. Only 17% of Americans, which means 83% of Americans don't understand the term to mean that. So what exactly does socialism mean today in America? Well, you look at some of the polls and there it gets really amusing, especially when you talk to the millennials. One poll, a major one that was done by Reason and the Roop Foundation, found that for a lot of millennials, socialism means being together. So might I remind you, it also means, by the way, being kind to one another. Need I remind you that the last occupant of the White House was fond of saying that kindness covers all of my political beliefs. That very same survey found that for a lot of millennials, socialism means the government pays for our needs, i.e. exactly what we're now doing, except more of it. My favorite one is the Gallup poll that found that 6%, not of millennials, but of all Americans, I don't want you to think I'm picking on millennials here, the ignorance is widespread, 6% of Americans think that socialism means talking to people, being social, social media, getting along with people. Which, by the way, is the same percentage of Americans who think that socialism means communism. In sum, this is not your grandfather's socialism. I'll put the matter even more bluntly. Socialism, as we understand it today, ain't the socialism of the past. This, by the way, to me is encouraging. That's the reason I want to harp on this, is this gives me hope. It doesn't crush my spirit that all is lost, as I think people have no idea what they're talking about. But what I would say to drive home this point is that when the overwhelming majority of people understand a term differently than when it was once used, that can mean one of two things. Either they don't know what the term means, or the meaning of the term has changed. In this case, I think it's a combination of both. And I don't think it should surprise us that when people today in America hear socialism, they don't think of the Soviet Union. They don't think of communism. They don't think of 100 million people dead. They don't think of Mao. They don't think of Stalin. Why? Well, first of all, in America, we teach the Howard Zinn version of history, not the real version of history. We teach people that when it comes to the past, the only thing you really need to know is that there was slavery and it was very bad. There was Jim Crow and it was very bad. There was Nazism and it was very bad. And then there was colonialism and imperialism, and these were also very bad. And that's about it. You should know that white people are very, very bad. They've killed a lot of people in the past, and that's about it. I guarantee that in our schools, they are not teaching them the Black Book of Communism, that people do not know that 100 million people in the 20th century died because of communism and left-wing socialism, leaving out, of course, National Socialism, which even though contains the word socialism in it, is never classified as socialism. Why then would you expect people, especially the younger generation, to view the term negatively if they've never been taught what it does? And by the way, we're not teaching people economics either. So I used to work when I started in DC, I got my first job at the American Councils of Trustees and Alumni. And one of our signature reports there was a massive survey of 1,100 colleges and universities in the country looking at what are they actually requiring of their students. And the report is called What Will They Learn? If you're curious, you can go look it up at the break and see how your school fares. And we would rank them on 7 subjects. Do you require English? Do you require foreign language? Do you require science? Do you require a history class? Do you require a class in government? Pop quiz. What percentage of the 1,100 top-ranked schools in the country have an economics requirement? No, this is colleges and universities. Out of the 1,100 schools in the country, how many of them have an econ requirement? 3%. And then, I won't bore you with the details, but I mean, look at the surveys on economic illiteracy amongst the American people. This is not taught. Why would we expect people to know it? And then, most important of all, today in America, when our socialists speak of socialism, who are they invoking? When Bernie starts going wobbly at the knees and tearing up about socialism, is he thinking about Maduro in Venezuela? About the Castro brothers in Cuba? About the madman Kim Jong-un in North Korea? Who does he talk about? No. Europe is too broad. Europe has the crazy right-wing governments of Italy and of Poland and of Hungary. No. And then the crazy people who want to do Brexit, he doesn't talk about Europe. Who does he talk about? Yes. Exactly. When I talk about democratic socialism, he told MSNBC, I'm not looking at Venezuela and Cuba. I'm looking at countries like Denmark and Sweden. End quote. Now, what's interesting is when he looks at Denmark and Sweden and Norway, he has very selective vision. Let's just say that all of our socialists are enamored with a highly romanticized version of Sweden. So Sweden is always their favorite Scandinavian country. And I really can't resist pointing some of this out to you because I find these are wonderful talking points to stick it to arrogant little smug socialist wannabes who think, well, why can't we be more like Sweden? And I love to say, oh, really? So you want universal school choice because they have it in Sweden and we don't? You want to have private health care and require people to have a copay when they use their government health care? Because, by the way, Medicare for All would ban all private health care and would not allow a copay. And Sweden has both. You want to get rid of the minimum wage, just like Sweden, because Sweden has no mandatory minimum wage. Oh, you also, by the way, want to give us a consumption tax and heavy taxes on the middle class, right? Because they love to make it sound like we're going to pay for all of this by raising taxes on not you, them, the rich. Well, that's not the way that Sweden does it. And you know, by the way, what else Sweden does not have? Sweden does not have elective late-term abortions. Sweden does not give citizenship to the children of illegal aliens, nor does it give them free health care. By the way, all of which are things that we do today in America, and some of which we would do if Bernie Sanders became president. All of which to say that this Sweden that exists in the imagination of Bernie Sanders, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, and all of our socialists is a far cry from the real Sweden. They have this romanticized image of the country. And while we're talking about Sweden, by the way, there are two things that I really cannot resist pointing out that bubble up inside of me, and it'll be therapeutic for me to let them come out. First of all, why the hell are we comparing ourselves to Sweden? We are a nation of 330 million people that spans a continent. We put a man on the moon. We won World War II. We are the greatest superpower in the world, and our standard of comparison is a nation of 10 million people that gave us IKEA and ABBA. That is what we're comparing ourselves to. What is the total population of Scandinavia? 21 million. I mean, do you realize the ridiculousness? Do you think China is comparing itself to Finland? I mean, it is ludicrous. And then also, and look, I don't mean to be disrespectful to the Swedes, but they are a rather morose people, okay? Is that really who we want to look up to? Have any of you watched the movies of Ingmar Bergman? I mean, does this align with the joyful, optimistic, it's morning again in America, American spirit? No, it isn't. Why would we model ourselves on such a people? Let Sweden be Sweden, and let's have America be America, and enough with these silly comparisons. Now, if we get back to our socialists and their supporters, okay, if their model is this romanticized version of Sweden, what you come to realize is socialism for them today in America, for Bernie, for Alexandria,
for the millennials, for the Democrats, for the Gen Zs, on the whole, is basically not Marxism, but just liberalism. Good old American progressive liberalism with one big difference. You remember what Bill Clinton was compelled to say in the 90s after Gingrich slapped him down with the 94 revolution? What did he say? These guys do not believe that the era of big government is over. This is a bold, self-confident, unapologetic progressivism that is not afraid to make demands and refuses to compromise. Our socialists want absolutely everything that the liberals and the progressives want, except they want more of it and they don't want to wait. They want greater government involvement in all sectors of life, and they want more free stuff. In theory, American socialism today and liberal progressivism are indistinguishable. You don't believe me? Let me give you an example. Okay, let's compare Bernie Sanders' socialism to Barack Obama's progressivism. Okay, Obama called himself a progressive. Both of them understand themselves in opposition to a caricature of sink or swim, social Darwinist, you're on your own, every last man, woman, and child for himself, Koch brothers funded, environment destroyed, rabid capitalism. They say, that's one option, we represent the alternative. Both of them want to preserve all of the government we now have and add some more. Both of them also realize, this is the key thing, that it's much more efficient to compel the private sector to do what the government wants it to do, rather than to have the government do it itself directly. Of course there are differences. I mean, what's the most obvious difference between Obama and Sanders, aside from the labels they use? Obama gave us Obamacare, Bernie Sanders wants to give us Medicare for all. But these are second-order practical disagreements. Both of them believe that healthcare is a fundamental human right. Both of them agree that the government should pay for it. And both of them agree that it is not smart to have the government actually run the hospitals. No one in America wants VA for all. They want Medicare for all. The disagreement is, what is the best way to get the private sector to give everyone healthcare? Let me put it to you this way, in case you're not convinced. Is there a single person here in this room who actually believes that Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton, or Joe Biden, or any other mainstream Democratic politician who does not call himself a socialist, has any philosophical or principled objection to Medicare for all? Of course not. They have practical and prudential objections to it. They may think it's not going to win us elections, or we can't pay for it right now, but they don't have a philosophical objection to why the government shouldn't do this, because they can't have one, because ultimately they're both in bed with one another and they're both species of progressivism. So if you want to understand the socialism that we're dealing with today, I would not bone up on Marx, Lenin, and Trotsky. I would study the history of American progressivism and liberalism in the 20th century so that you can see that this is a continuation, an intensification, I think is the better word, of what we have had in America now, basically since the New Deal. The demands are what they've always been. They are threefold. The progressive agenda, the liberal agenda, the socialist agenda have three central demands. The first one is, what's the main one? Their main appeal, and they're always their most urgent demand. From the New Deal until today. More what? Government doing what? Yeah, it's always more government. You're right. That's just their one demand. But government does a variety of things for them. What's the number one thing they want the government to do? Free stuff. Entitlements. So our left has an inferiority complex vis-a-vis Sweden. Here's how it goes. Do we take care of the elderly in America? Do we have massive entitlements that help the elderly? Yes. They're called Medicare and Social Security. Do we have a welfare state for the poor? Yes, it's called Medicaid and the other 80 different means-tested welfare programs we administer in America. What do we not have that they want really, really badly? We don't have middle-class universal entitlements. We don't have free college. We don't have free healthcare. We don't have free daycare. We don't have free paid leave. This is what they want. And they lead with that because it's the most appealing thing, right? Telling people they're going to get free stuff. But this is a very old idea. I am pretty sure, but don't quote me on this, that Teddy Roosevelt was the first person to declare that healthcare was a right and to suggest that the government should provide it. And then if you read FDR's 1944 State of the Union address, the famous Second Bill of Rights address, right there he says that healthcare is a right. They've been going at it piecemeal, Medicare, Medicaid, Obamacare. The end goal has always been free healthcare for everyone. And they're not going to stop there. I think you understand that, right? After healthcare, we need college, daycare, and then there'll be internet. The basic argument is that, as FDR put it, necessitous men are not free men. Unless you can pay to do something, you're not free to do it. That's why they want the government to pay for abortions. The argument is a woman really free to choose to have an abortion if she can't afford it? No. Therefore, the government should pay for it. The government should pay for your sex change. The government should pay for everything. That's one major demand. The second one is, well, how do we pay for all of this? We raise taxes on the rich. Always the rich and the wealthy. We do that for two reasons. One is because we need to pay for all of this. And you guys never need to pay. Don't worry. Like I said, in Sweden, they pay. For some reason, here, we're not going to pay. We're running trillion-dollar deficits. We're $21 trillion in the hole. But we're going to add massive entitlements. But only the rich will pay for it. And then the other thing is this allows us to reduce inequality. So they are very, very big on redistribution. Again, nothing new here. What was the highest marginal tax rate in American history, by the way? Does anyone know? 92% in 1952. So we don't have a wealth tax in the US. It is true. That's something they want. Elizabeth Warren wants that. But we do have an estate tax. So an intensification of it, but nothing new. And then the third one, I think, is really the key one to really see the difference between our socialism and Marxist socialism. They want to preserve the private sector. They just want to box it in and have the government tell it what to do with regulations. So one of the cornerstones of the left's mind, to understand, to put yourself in the shoes of the left, is the distrust of the private and the unshakable faith in the public. Here's how they think. The private sector is driven by what? What's the ruling passion there? Greed, selfishness, individualism. Very, very bad. No cooperation. What, according to them, not in practice, of course, in theory, is the ruling passion of the public sector? What virtue in particular? Public service. Devotion to the common good. Impartiality, neutrality, and expertise, right? So if you want to do environmental regulations, you can't go to Congress. These guys are going to listen to lobbyists, and then they're not that smart. The way to do it is to have the wise, neutral, impartial experts in the EPA, right, who, of course, are not subject to any kinds of pressures, and there's no such thing as cronyism, regulatory capture. None of that happens. But these people can legislate and regulate impartially on behalf of the public good. Now, you could see, therefore, where Marxism comes along. The promise of Marxism is to abolish the private sector completely, to eliminate selfishness. This is the greatest promise of Marx, is once we implement communism, species being will reemerge. Human nature will be transformed. We will no longer view each other as individuals, but like the fingers of the hand. Yes, I'm this finger, but then I'm connected to the hand. This is Marx, in a sense, most insane promise. Now, how did that work out in practice when it was implemented in all of the countries that tried communism and socialism? It didn't work well. Aside from all of the terrible violence and repression, which, by the way, okay, if you ever get to meet a Sanders-type like person, they love to say, of course we're not defending the violence and the repression in the Soviet Union, as if it's an accidental byproduct of a regime aimed at destroying the private. How are you not going to need violence to teach people not to love their families and to want to hold on to what is theirs? Of course you need violence. It is absolutely baked into the system. But they will say, no, we didn't like the political aspect of it. But you know, there was I'm sorry, I got lost in making fun of Bernie. I was going to make an off-color joke about Bernie, but I thought otherwise about it, so I got lost in my mind. Aside from this terrible record of violence and political repression, I think you also know that the economies of these countries were horrible, right? They had constant shortages. I don't mean to offend. It's not a Polish joke. It's a Polish communist joke, okay? I got a Polish communist joke for you. Are you Polish? Okay, it's a Polish communist joke. The wife comes home and tells her husband, if I had eggs, I'd make you a ham omelet, but I have no ham. You don't get it? She has neither egg. Okay, well. They always ran out of things. Here, however, we never run out of things. Our left did learn, I think, one lesson from the 20th century is that communism and socialism leads to shortages all the time. So they said, huh, why don't we do a hybrid system? So look, you, sir, you get to keep your corporation. All yours. I'm not owning it. However, okay, you listen to the EEOC, who tells you who to hire, who to fire, who to promote, to OSHA, that tells you how to set up your workplace, to the EPA, that tells you how to produce what it is you produce. Also, I tell you that you need to pay your employees this much. You need to pay for their health care. You need to pay for their contraceptives, for their abortions. Oh, and also, you need to pay your fair share of taxes. But hey, the company's all yours. Now, you may say, well, you know, okay, that's still not good because it's clearly not free markets. There are all of these regulations being imposed on you. But isn't it an improvement over socialism? In a sense, it is, but there's a way in which what we have is more pernicious. Can you think of why? If you lived in Ceausescu's Romania and you went to the store and they've run out of everything, who do you blame? The government. Everyone hated the government because everyone knew that the government was screwing things up. When things go bad here, who do we blame? So say in 2008, whose fault was it? The private sector. Greed and deregulation on Wall Street. Well, hold on one second, but what about Freddie Mae and Fannie Mae and the government saying everyone in America needs to have a house? No, we don't talk about that part. And by the way, what do we do in response to 2008? We pass Dodd-Frank. Because under our system, no one can really measure the toll on the private sector that the government has taken. Because its hands are just pushing here, here, and here, and there, but are hidden. And that we tell the people that we have a capitalist system, when in fact we have a hybrid system, the advantage is we're more productive, we have more growth. The disadvantage is the presence of the state is concealed. And there is always an argument for more government, more regulations when things go bad. And also, by the way, you could see why millennials and young people become enamored with socialism. 2008 happens. Immediately, everyone blames capitalism. And then the pollsters call you and say, hey, what do you prefer, socialism or capitalism? So you have no idea what socialism is because no one taught you in school. You just saw capitalism in action, colossal financial collapse. Well, obviously, you say, I prefer socialism. This is another thing that explains the polling. So basically, what I'm telling you is, until we conservatives succeed in dislodging from the national consciousness the idea that 2008 was caused by the private sector, you will continue to see that socialism remains very popular in America, especially amongst young people. So what do we do about all of this? And I'll end by saying this, and then we can open it up to questions and discuss this further together. What I really wanted to do today, the first was to get you not to despair at all of these polls. These polls are silly. I don't want you to think that America's over, that you should give up on free markets, give up on limited government, because everyone buys into socialism. That is most emphatically not the case. I also, by the way, I'm not telling you not to use the label socialist to hit them hard if it works. I just am somewhat skeptical of how powerful an insult socialist is in America today. Nazism is bad. Everyone knows that, and everyone knows that racism is bad because everyone teaches this every day. Communism, central planning, we know it's bad. I think most people don't. So I don't think it's the smartest rhetorical strategy if we want to destroy them to put all of our eggs into calling them socialists. What about countering them? This is where it gets tricky, and I would say two things. Look, the first one is, at an emotional level, we can never compete with socialism. It is just not possible to have a system that competes in theory and rhetorically and emotionally with the promises of leftism, progressivism, liberalism, and socialism. We cannot promise a world in which everyone is happy all the time. We cannot promise a world in which there is no more war. We're conservatives. We have too sober and dim a view of human nature. We can promise rising prosperity. We can promise more opportunity. We cannot compete with them rhetorically, and therefore they will always have an edge over us, especially with young people. Look, Ayn Rand did more than anyone could ever do to ennoble capitalism and to make entrepreneurs admirable figures, and God bless her for that. But that is still no match for the insane pipe dreams that the left can promise you. So we are at a structural disadvantage when it comes to competing with them for the affections of the people. The one thing I would urge you, and this is where I'll end, is one mistake I think we make is the following one. So Bernie and company come along and they want to give you everything for free, okay? Everything's free and only the rich need to pay for more taxes. We have a tendency to resort to hardline libertarianism as the response to that, saying, no, healthcare is not a right. The government shouldn't be doing anything, and we're going to get rid of Social Security, and we're going to get rid of Medicare because they're unconstitutional, and they're going to bankrupt the country. We may be right in theory, but we live in a democracy. The American people get to vote, and that is a good thing. And the American people have made quite clear that they like the New Deal, and that they like the Great Society, and that they are concerned with the hard edges of markets. The American people have not said that they want to do away with capitalism. They have not said that they are envious of the wealthy and that they hate entrepreneurship and prosperity. But they have made clear that there is an edge to markets, an insecurity, that they would like some help from the government in dealing with. And I think that the way to win over the reasonable American people is to not come across as fanatics. If we give the American people a choice between socialism and purist libertarianism, they will pick socialism. And don't take my word for it. You may say, what the hell do you know? You're a Canadian, you're already a socialist, we shouldn't listen to you. This is Reagan and Hayek. You know, one myth we tell ourselves, I don't know if Yaf says this, so I hope I won't offend anyone, is that Goldwater won in 64, it just took them 16 years to count the votes. That is not true. Reagan was much more moderate than Goldwater. Goldwater was opposed to the New Deal. Reagan was not. Now, Reagan believed in markets, he believed in the Constitution, he believed in limited government, he believed in so many things that we should believe in. He was not a fanatic. Ditto, by the way, with Hayek. Hayek was extremely concerned that we preserve markets, that we not replace competition and signaling through supply and demand with central planning. But Hayek recognized that it is okay to have a welfare state and some regulations. So the key challenge for us as conservatives and as reasonable libertarians is to find a way to respond to the legitimate anxieties of the American people, to counter the hard left, and to find a way to preserve the architecture of liberty we inherited from our forefathers. Thank you, and I am. We got plenty of time for questions. I hope so. Do you need a mic? Is there a system? How does it work? Oh. Well, you don't. Okay. Well, as you wish.
Thank you for joining us, Dr. Azerrad. My question is, you talked a little bit about how conservatism emerged in the 1950s, kind of the diffusion between conservatives and libertarians. How do you see the relationship between conservatives and libertarianism in fighting this new kind of wave of socialism?
Well, I think that, how shall I put, so look, I would distinguish free market economics from libertarianism. I'm free market economics are immensely important, and economists have a lot to teach us about the failures of good intention, regulatory capture, public choice theory, all the things that could go wrong. You know, conservatives sometimes think that, well, you know, why don't we can also fix it through the government. And we can sometimes, but we need to be a little bit restrained. What I worry about with the libertarians is the purist fanaticism that is just completely off-putting to the overwhelming majority of Americans. I mean, it resonates with people who work at the Cato Foundation and kids your age who go to Young Americans for Liberty conferences. And the professional libertarians like to trick you into believing that vast segments of the American people are, you know, just like you, socially conservative and fiscally conservative and socially liberal. That's nonsense. I mean, if you look at a breakup of the electorate, it's like 3.5% who fit the libertarian box. So I come back to my point. If the choice we give to the American people is socialism of the Bernie Sanders variety, i.e. the government takes care of you and we're going to raise taxes on the riches, and a lot of people don't with that, but if the alternative is this kind of fanatical, intransigent, well, to hell with you, you get your own health care, we're going to lose a lot of people. So I want them in the movement to help us with economic thinking. I don't want them setting the agenda and the rhetoric, because I find it is deeply alienating to the overwhelming majority of people. Look, something that libertarians, the more honest ones, will end up admitting. That's why they start to flirt with non-democracy. You can't reconcile these two things. You cannot reconcile living in a republic, majority will, the people vote, with the libertarian agenda today in America. The people have spoken. They want a lot of government. They don't want as much government as Bernie is giving them, but they want a whole lot more government than Rand Paul would give them. That's what I would tell you. And then the challenge for us is to figure out what's the right way to do it. And look, I will say this is an area where I think there's room for improvement on the right. You know, have we really figured out our response on healthcare? So we've got some ideas on how to fix Medicare and Medicaid. Then you got the 90% of people who get their healthcare through their employer. They're generally happy. But then, yeah, we got this population of about 30 million people, right? The pre-existing conditions, the non-insured, they can't afford it. What do we do with them? I mean, I think, you know, you may want to say, well, they should just figure out on their own. I don't think the American people are with us anymore. So we can either lose them to Medicare for all or come up with a reasonable market-oriented solution that helps them and preserves as much liberty in America as is possible.
Thank you so much.
Sure. My entrepreneur friend whose company was subjected to all the regulations.
Yes, I wanted to ask two things. Basically, when you look at socialism, we obviously have all this, you know, these trends in history that no one wants. But also in the past, you look at most of capitalism. And I'm a free market guy like anybody else, but you can't help but look at the past of imperialism, colonialism, and everything that has happened under the vehicle of capitalism.
Really?
As a historic, well, if you look at the arguments from the left, right, as far so that's the past. How do we redefine or change the narrative about the past and capitalism's role?
Yeah,
right?
I think a lot of work has been done in this area. I mean, I didn't touch upon this because this is, I think, pretty well-covered ground. First is, look, I'm not crazy about the term capitalism.
Right.
I think it has Marxist connotations, and it's kind of misleading because it implies that it's about capital. Whereas I like free markets because they're about spontaneous order, cooperation, they're about freedom, they're about letting people figure out what they want to do, and eventually we end up producing more plenty for everyone. So I find that, you know, one way to help ourselves is I prefer free markets to the word capitalism. Second, on the historical front, I mean, look, you know, imperialism and colonialism have nothing to do with free markets. Free markets are about people voluntarily producing, trading, and exchanging with one another. Colonialism and imperialism are about one people ruling another one without their consent. If there is one thing that markets are all about, it is consent. You don't need to buy anything you want, and you don't need to buy it at the price you don't want to buy it. So these things don't go together. In terms of the good that markets have done, I mean, I don't know, take any graph beginning in about, like the 18th century of the standard of living for all of humanity and look at what happens over the next 200-300 years. I mean, a colossal uplift of everyone across the board at uneven rates, mind you. Free markets have never promised that everyone would rise at the same rate, but it has lifted billions and billions of people out of poverty. I mean, look at China, right? China is another one of those hybrid models. They are authoritarian when it comes to politics and religion and free speech, but they also have this hybrid system when it comes to economics. Part of what has fueled the colossal growth of China in recent decades is the reforms they started implementing in the 80s to liberalize their economy. So there is, I think that free markets have an undeniable, spectacular track record of lifting billions of human beings out of poverty. And then I would tell the left, what is your track record? What does central planning and socialism have to show as a track record? 100 million dead bodies by the most conservative estimate. So that is not to say that markets can solve everything. Again, this is guarding against the libertarian fallacy. To say that, oh, well, markets work really well at this, let's just have markets do everything. Let's get rid of countries. No, markets are fantastic at distributing goods and services, encouraging innovation, and lifting people out of poverty. At the end of the day, though, we have countries. It's called the United States of America, not the United Markets of America. We have politics that trumps economics. And there are other dimensions to the common good that we're attentive to as conservatives and that are conducive to human flourishing. But one key component of it is undeniably markets. And every single historical example proves this. Israel, Sweden, Great Britain, India, all of these countries that tried the command and control system, all of them had to abandon it and liberalize their economy in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And the results have been a colossal improvement in the state of living. My dad is from Israel. I mean, Israel basically started off as a semi-communist country. All of the guys who founded it were Eastern Europeans who were enamored with socialism. And then Bibi has his faults, but one thing he did in the 90s was he really opened up the economy. And Israel today is like high-tech, super booming economy across the board, not because of its communist origins, because of its the transformation of its economy along market lines. And I could give you countless more examples.
And so going into my second, so that's the past, but also, like you said, you were talking about America today and what Americans want, you know, moving forward, and they want more government and everything like that.
Well, no, hold on. No, I didn't say that. I said they want some government. They are not fanatic libertarians.
Right.
They are on the right on the whole. They are not Swedes. They are not Russians. They don't want the full left's agenda, but we can't delude ourselves into thinking that they just hate the government and want nothing to do with it. You know, there's an apocryphal Tea Party sign that I don't know if it really happened, but I spent enough time with Tea Partiers to vouch for the sentiment. The sign said, "Get your government hands off my Medicare." There's an awful lot of our folks who think that way, and we should be attentive to that when we're messaging. But please go on.
Yes, and so what is the, I guess, cultural, conservative answer to bigger issues like climate change and all these other issues from a populace that wants or is turned off by some of these more, don't tread on me sort of sort of
yeah.
sentiments, right? What well, is the what well, is I the mean, way to?
I mean, there's. I mean, I don't even know where to begin. It's everything that the Heritage Foundation does. It's everything that AEI does. It's everything that Hoover and Hudson do. It is national affairs. It's American affairs. It's. I mean, look. Pretty much the entirety of the intellectual right in America, with the exception of the hardline libertarians, is devoted to the task of how do we govern? How do we reform these clunky, outdated, inefficient institutions of government? How do we meet the anxieties of the American people through market mechanisms? How do we deal with climate change through market mechanisms? I mean, one of my colleagues, Nick Loris, is an environmentalist who does all free market approaches to dealing with this. So you pick the issue. Conservatives have done a lot of work on this. Maybe healthcare is the one that is perhaps, I think, a little bit underdeveloped, but even there, this is not really my expertise at the granular level. But I would tell you, you know, drive down 23 miles down the highway, come to DC, and at Ramden, pick a major conservative organization. They're all working on this. No one is saying, well, we're just gonna get rid of everything. Because, look, that ain't gonna happen anytime soon. So we gotta figure out how to govern and how to appeal to the reasonable middle. So we're all working on this.
Hello, thank you for coming. Bonsoir.
Bonsoir.
I had a question about George Orwell, who many conservatives read his works because they are, you know, pretty conservative, but he also considers himself a socialist. So how would you make the distinction between Orwellian socialism and what we were talking about?
Well, so look, I don't know what Orwell means by socialism. I mean, the term, you know, if you, so where does the term come from? I mean, it comes from pre-Marxist 19th century socialists, many of them French, like Fourier, but also an Englishman named Owen, they coined the term socialism. Marx and Engels used the terms communism and socialism interchangeably. Lenin is the one who introduces the distinction between the first phase of communism is called socialism, that's the government control of the means of production, and then the second phase of communism is called communism. That's when the state withers away. So in Marxist thought, that becomes the distinction. And so according to the Marxist, we have never had communism. We've only had socialism because we never got to the stage where the private property was abolished and the state withered away. Then you get, I don't exactly know beginning when, you get democratic socialism. Kind of, you know, basically this hybrid welfare state, administrative state model that I've been describing that you find in Scandinavia, but across Europe, in Canada, in Australia, and in America. So a lot of these people say, you know, I believe in democratic socialism, which is meant to be the middle route between free market purism, so all the government does nothing, and then full-blown Soviet-style socialism. We're gonna occupy a middle ground. You know, at one point they called themselves liberals, so Arthur Schlesinger, that was his big thing, the middle road in the 50s. A lot of them say we're democratic socialists. I mean, the terms, so it can mean an awful lot of things. I don't know what it meant for Orwell, do you?
I think, for him, it was almost a reaction to aristocracy and just kind of this big gap between the wealthy and the poor and poverty in the streets of London and everything, because he's English, so it's just different situation. And so I think it's more just, it's a very, like, I think for him, it's kind of a very vague way of saying that wealth needs to be, like, distributed, need to, like, increase the middle class.
Every single Western nation has a welfare state, has strict regulations on the private sector, has progressive taxation. I mean, that a consensus has emerged in the West that this is what the people want. And no one really challenges it fundamentally. Mm-hmm. And those who do really are on the margins of our political life, like hardline libertarians. I don't mean to pick on, I hope I'm not offending anyone here, but there's just no public support for any of this. Mm-hmm. And there hasn't been for a long time. And so I come back to my examples of Reagan and Hayek, people whose, you know, free market bona fides are unquestionable, but who understood this fact and therefore were comfortable with some regulations, some taxes, and some welfare state. Mm-hmm. I really don't see an alternative to it
right.
in the West. So if maybe that's what Orwell meant by that, but seeing that I am not familiar with those writings of his, I can't speak to that.
Yeah, it's the book, it's called Why I Write. So that's the work that I'm referring to.
Okay. No, I've only read Animal Farm in 1984.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you.
Sure.
Hi there. I believe in your speech you mentioned something about how free market advocates are going to be at a disadvantage morally to socialists.
Emotionally. Yeah.
And I believe that fundamentally that's a problem because I was raised in a household personally where you had to earn your meal sort of thing. You'd feel guilty if you didn't earn your way in life. And I'm just wondering what your suggestion would be for someone like me and for us in this room who are young and trying to kind of change the world and how we see it in that way where we're trying to get people to realize that you do have to earn your way. Not everybody deserves what everybody else does because not everybody provides as much as everybody else. How do you think we can do something like that?
Well, I mean, you know, so look, one has to be a colossal recovery of the past and all of the failures of the, you know, heavy-handed command and control, excessive redistributionist approaches to governing. That my point was, I think most people don't know this because we don't teach it to them. We teach them the Holocaust and that's about it, and slavery. And then they move on to social justice and recycling today. So one would have to be people understanding how many times this has been tried in various variations and doesn't work. The other one has to be, you know, look, there's the fiscal argument. I just find that it doesn't convince a lot of people. I mean, it convinces me what we're doing is completely unsustainable. But one problem we've had is we have a bit of the symptom of the boy who's been crying wolf for one too many times. We have been warning about a financial apocalypse now since, you know, Reagan was warning about it in 1964, the time for choosing. So we have been on a mode of, we can't afford this, it's all gonna, and it keeps on going. It is absolutely gonna collapse one day. It is just not sustainable. But I think a lot of people have tuned us out because we've been saying this for such a long time, and for some reason the government keeps on borrowing. People still have faith in the US currency, and therefore the economy hasn't collapsed, and the chickens have not come home to roost. And then I think there's a psychological approach to this of what is fulfilling as a human being? I mean, wherein do we find satisfaction? Is it through handouts and dependency, or is it through overcoming, achievement, and effort? I think the latter, obviously, and it is compatible with a safety net, with recognizing that some people are gonna have a harder time and some people, you know, are quite unlucky and we should care for them. But that the broad contours of them are, if you wanna find happiness, if you wanna lead a flourishing life, I think we have a much better recipe. My only point was just that it's not as grandiose of a vision because conservatism is not a utopia. It is inherently anti-utopian. Whereas progressivism, liberalism, socialism, they're all utopian ideologies. And human beings, you know, like tales. So I think we can do better, but we should be understand, if the point is to understand the enemy does have a leg up on us in this regard, that they have a very sexy rhetorical package.
I would almost still even disagree. I would think that it's more short-term empathy that they see. They don't see the long-term because they can't see the consequences of where their actions are taking them. And I'm struggling with trying to find a way to convince them that conservatism is in their long-term interests, that just handouts in the short term isn't going to give them the purpose that they're looking for.
I mean, look, the way I found to do that, the left has two, they're not fatal conceits, but it has, of the endless prejudices they have, I mean, their great prejudice is that they have no prejudice, by the way. That is the left's greatest prejudice, is all of you guys are racist hicks who cling to your guns and your religion. We see the world unvarnished as it is. Okay, nonsense. But when they look at us, I think the two fundamental things you need to dislodge from their minds is, the main one actually is that we don't care. The left claims to have a monopoly on the heart. They claim to have a monopoly on the mind too, right? All of the smart people agree with this. And look, they all went to Harvard with this. We're all very, very smart and we know everything. except we didn't predict 2016, we didn't predict 2008, we didn't predict 2001, and we didn't predict the collapse of the Soviet Union. But aside from that, we're very, very smart. But they really believe that they have a monopoly on the heart. They believe that the left is co-equal with caring, and that everyone on the right is fundamentally heartless, either because we're racist and we hate people who are not white, or because we're sexist and we hate women, you know the list of all of these isms, or because we're greedy, ruthless capitalists who don't care about the poor. Either way, we don't care about our fellow Americans. And that is most emphatically not true. And that has to be dislodged from their minds. And then that's, I think, sets up a conversation over not should we help our fellow Americans, of course we should, how do we best help them? But you're not going to get them to listen to you until you convince them that it is not true that you don't care. I'm sorry if this sounds a little bit Oprah-ish and Dr. Phil and we should all hug each other and say how much we love each other and care, but yeah, but it is just the fact. They are convinced that they have a monopoly on the heart, and that has to be refuted. And then let's have the much better conversation of what is your track record of helping people? What is ours? What best helps people? And so on and so forth. I would say that's the key thing that has to be dislodged from their minds.
All right. Thank you so much.
Sure.
I don't have the microphone here, so I'm just going to shout. Thank you, Dr.